Surgical resections may be necessary for treatment of trauma, disease of the upper gastrointestinal tract, or even to treat obesity. In this video, we will differentiate between different types of stomach surgery, explain the physiology of the various gastric surgeries, identify benefits of bariatric surgery, and complications that occur. There are various types of surgeries to the stomach that can be divided into two main categories. Gastrectomy is a partial or total removal of the stomach. These types of surgeries are generally used for medical necessity in the case of severe problems to the stomach, such as cancer, ulcers, abscess, or uncontrolled bleeding. Bariatric surgery is used to treat obesity. Let's begin with the gastrectomy. In each case of a partial or total removal of the stomach, the small intestine must be rerouted to the portion of the remaining stomach. Whenever possible, the duodenum, which is the first section of the small intestine, is left because this is where the pancreatic juices and bile enter. By leaving the duodenum, it helps prevent malabsorption of nutrients. I think many people have a hard time grasping the idea of a total gastrectomy. It will not be without complications, but a person can survive without a stomach. Note in each type of surgery, the pyloric sphincter is removed. The role of this sphincter is to keep food in the stomach and allow only small amounts into the small intestine at a time. Loss of this sphincter will present a major complication. When it comes to surgery for obesity, there are many different types. We will discuss the three most common types. The first surgery is an adjustable gastric band. A band is placed at the top of the portion of the stomach, so the person will feel full very quickly when eating, thereby reducing calorie intake. This type of surgery is purely a restrictive type of surgery, simply restricting the amount of food consumed. This surgery is the least invasive surgery, leaving all of the anatomy of the stomach, but it also has the least success. It is completely reliant on the person following their diet by eating less food and exercising. The second surgery is gastric bypass, which is the most popular type of surgery. In this case, the surgeon staples a portion of the stomach to create a small pouch at the top. Then the jejunum, which is the second part of the small intestine, is attached to this pouch. In this surgery, the duodenum is bypassed because that is where pancreatic enzymes and bile enter. Bypassing that section impairs the ability to digest food consumed. So this type of surgery is both restrictive and malabsorptive. It is the most successful of the surgeries, but it has the most complications. The third type of surgery is the sleeve gastrectomy, which has been gaining in popularity. In this surgery, a large portion of the stomach is removed so that only about 15% of it is left. This is also a restrictive type of surgery, but it removes such a large portion of the stomach that complications are more severe, especially with nutrient malabsorption, than we see with the band surgeries. It has a fairly good success rate for obtaining desired weight loss. The reason gastric surgery is used for obesity is that the success is much higher than people achieve with diet and exercise. There are physiological reasons for this. In both the gastric bypass and gastric sleeve, there is less stomach, resulting in less ghrelin production. Ghrelin is a hormone that signals hunger. So one of the benefits to treating obesity long-term is less hunger after surgery. Since the stomach volume is smaller, when the person does eat, they consume much less food and fewer calories. The resulting weight loss can minimize and potentially reverse severe chronic complications of obesity. In the case of gastric band and gastric sleeve, surgery is not as invasive as gastric bypass and leaves more anatomy of the gut, especially the pyloric sphincter. I bring up the pyloric sphincter because one of the biggest complications we have with gastric surgeries has to do with the loss of the pylorus. When the pyloric sphincter is removed or bypassed, as is the case with all of the gastrectomies and gastric bypass, the food dumps from the stomach into the small intestine. This results in an increased concentration in the lumen of the small intestine, causing fluid from the circulating bloodstream to shift into the small intestine. With less fluid in the bloodstream, pressure falls, causing weakness, dizziness, rapid heartbeat, and sweating. In addition, the large influx of fluid into the gut causes hyperparastalsis, resulting in pain, cramping, and diarrhea. But that's not the end of it. When all of the carbohydrates dumped into the small intestine and absorbed into the bloodstream, blood sugars rise. The pancreas then responds by dumping insulin to lower those large amounts of glucose. Because everything from the stomach dumped into the small intestine to be absorbed, there's nothing left to bring blood sugars back up. So then blood sugars bottom out and leave the person feeling dizzy, faint, nauseated. Dumping syndrome is a very common complication, with simple sugar as the main culprit in the increased concentration, fluid shift, and blood sugar changes. No matter if the surgery is a gastrectomy or bariatric surgery for weight loss, the nutritional consequences can be severe. Since each of the surgeries limits food consumption, nutrient deficiencies are common. The stomach has very specific roles with absorption of iron, B12, folate, and calcium. Any of the surgeries that decrease the size of the stomach is likely to have nutrient deficiencies because the role of the stomach is also reduced. Bile from the liver and gallbladder enters the duodenum of the small intestine. Therefore, any surgery bypassing the duodenum results in fat and fat-soluble vitamin malabsorption. Bone disease is likely, as well as gallbladder disease. Gastric surgery comes with some pretty severe complications that must be taken into consideration. As you consider the physiology of the different types of surgery, think about how nutrition is affected and what measures will be necessary to prevent malnutrition and other complications like dumping syndrome.